Lord God, you promised to be in the midst. We bind attitudes. We bind bad things. can authority over every work of the devil. Lord, we plead the blood of Jesus right now. Lord, we come before you in the name of Jesus. Hold the music for a minute. Father, we come into your presence right now. Lord, come, we decree and declare that every enemy is under our feet. We decree and declare that every power of darkness is cast down. We decree and declare the spirit of lethargy has no hold over this place. There is no agenda that matters but your agenda. There is no worship that matters but your worship. Lord God, we're not holding on to the past. We're looking forward to the future. Lord, we expect great things. We expect great things. We expect great things. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. People are coming from miles around to worship here in Michael's and church. They are coming, Lord God, for the word. They're coming for your presence. They're coming for your healing. And every demonic force that will seek to keep this from happening, we thrust him out. We cast him into the outer atmosphere. We confine him to the works of darkness and dark places where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Lord, we open our mouth and we begin to bless you. We honor you and we glorify you. Lord, we sing the praise to you. You are the mighty God, the everlasting God, the faithful God, the all-encompassing God. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great are you. Shout out to the commandment of the revolution. Lord God, we take authority over overwhelming grief. We take authority over every distraction. We will not give our flesh the praise. We will not give our distractions the praise. We will not give, Lord God, our concerns the praise. With our hands lifted up and our mouth filled with praise, with our heart of thanksgiving, we bless you, Lord. We decree Satan is under our feet. He is a defeated foe. His works are shut down. And no weapon formed against his prosperous. Somebody let out a praise. Hallelujah. Lord, I need everything in me to shout hallelujah. I need everybody in here to shout hallelujah. Don't look around, open your mouth and bless the Lord and declare hallelujah. Father, we're about to hear your word. We thank you. Hallelujah, we thank you. Satan, we see you and we will not give you peace. We focus our attention on you and we worship you. Hallelujah. And Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks. There is no agenda greater than yours. And we give you praise and we give you thanks. Now, Lord, let our hearts hear you, receive you. Let our lives, oh Lord God, reflect you. And Lord, do something awesome in our lives today. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. Now one more time for the Lord, put those hands together and bless him. Thank you, Lord. I don't believe you want that. I think you can do much better than that. Come on, hallelujah. Glory to God. I feel Jesus up in here. Come on, let's praise your Holy Bibles, everybody. Lord, I thank you that I have a Bible. It is my personal copy. Basic instruction. Before leaving earth, I am a believer, not a doubt. I'm not just a hearer, but I'm also a doer. And my life is so much better because of the word of the living God. Therefore, I declare, my mind is alert. My heart is restored. And I will not be distracted today, but I will hear the word of the Lord concerning me. Now, Father, in advance, I open my mouth. Father, in advance, I open my mouth, and I give you glory in Jesus' name. Because I'm going to leave here better than I came here in Jesus' name. Now, you give God what's his. Give him what's his. Amen. It was God. Thank you for getting that on. Amen. Let's get ready to hear the word. As you remain standing, smile at somebody. As you remain standing, smile at somebody. Let them know you love them. You appreciate them. Amen. And you thank God for them. Open your Bibles to Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, verse 1. Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, verse 1. Please stand and let's respect the word. Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, and verse 1. Beloved, when the Holy Spirit fills your life, He changes your life for the better. Amen. From the inside.
Amen.
Can I get a better witness in that?
Amen.
Early on in this message series, before we read this text, beloved, we talked about the differences between conviction, condemnation, condoning, compromising, conversion, and true change. Somebody say true change.
True change.
Matter of fact, let's say all these words, all of you will see. Let's say conviction.
Condemnation.
Condoning.
Condoning.
Compromising. And true change. With conversion comes true change. Now, beloved, as you stand with me, in dealing with the sin nature of mankind, compromising leads to condoning. And eventually, condoning, which is passivity, leads to condemnation. When we see someone bleeding from the artery and tell them they're okay as they are, they are being condoned in this sin. But it is the work of the Holy Spirit that brings conviction. Somebody say conviction. And conviction, when the Holy Spirit has its perfect work, leads to the conversion. Conversion. And when conversion takes place, there's lasting and true change. Lasting. And true change. Somebody say lasting. And true change. So look at the neighbor and say, it doesn't matter what you do. If the Holy Ghost has changed my life, I got to live that change. Whether you like it or not. Tell somebody else, I love you. But when the Holy Ghost works in me, I am determined to live for the better. So beloved, the Holy Spirit comes to lead and to guide us into all truth. Can I hear a witness?
Amen.
He comes to remind us of the things that we have been taught. He is our sealer, the Bible says, unto the day of redemption. And again, I declare, He is a true agent of change.
Amen.
Can we read this text together as you're standing in Mark, actually Luke 10, 1 through, actually 19. 1 to 10, I'm excited. Let's read this text together out loud. If you don't have the King James, just read from our screen. Ready? Read. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was of the chief among the publicans. And he was rich, and he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the price. Because he was little of stature. That's why he was short. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him. For he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down. For today I must abide at thy house. You're good? And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest with the man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, This day is salvation. Come into this house. For as much as he also is the son of Abraham, for the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Amen. I want you to leave that text up all the time till I tell you to change it. I want to talk today about the power of our change.
Yeah.
The power of our change.
Yeah.
Look at somebody and say, it doesn't matter what anybody else does. When your heart is changed, you'll serve the Lord. You'll honor the Lord. You'll live for the Lord. Let's give God praise for heart change. Let me see it in the word of the Lord. Let's hear this word. I want to give you an example from this text. This is one of the greatest examples of heart change that I've ever seen. One of the greatest examples of heart change I've ever seen. Because this is where we are today, and I need you all to hear me. There's a lot of people that are trying to do church without the change that the Lord of the church brings to your life. You can't live holy without the influence and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. You can't keep His word without the influence and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Beloved, you have religion when you seek to please God solely by an act of your flesh instead of by the lead and guide of the Holy Spirit. So this is why so many of us do right for a period of time, but then it fizzles out like a car running out of gas, because there's nothing in and of your flesh that can even stay in love with God without the power of the Holy Ghost. One of the things, and I need y'all to hear me, because some of us think we're okay, and you hear the term today, I'm spiritual. Well, beloved, you can't be spiritual without the Spirit.
Amen.
You can be religious. You can dot I's, cross T's, and check off boxes. But you'll not really have the fullness of relationship with God without the Holy Ghost. You can say all the religious words you want. You can be kind. You can be just. And all that nice stuff gets you nothing unless God is filling your tank.
Amen.
Because after a while, the right person will make you forget it's a nice day. Anybody ever experienced that? You start off with a good day and the wrong person, which as far as the enemy is concerned, the right person says something off key, and you got to struggle to get back that smile.
That's right.
Y'all never experienced it. Tell somebody, no lie, keep living. Somebody cuts you off. Somebody, you go into a seat on the subway, and somebody brushes past you to beat you to it. One day, somebody said a little bit ago, This lady saw me have my blinker on, give it to go to his pocket space. Y'all know what happened. She saw me in the parking lot with my blinker on and hurry up and went in that space and said, oh, you should have been quicker. The anger, the frustration. How dare you? You saw me. And the Holy Spirit said, let it happen. So, beloved, in my flesh, I could have said, let it happen. But in the Spirit, the Lord said, keep your focus. See, without the Holy Ghost, we would all give in to our flesh, our feelings. I wish I had two honest people in here. So, when the Lord changes your heart, beloved, you don't have those struggles winning all the time. Yes, you do have those struggles, but you don't have them winning all the time. You might want to blacken somebody's eye, mom. But when the Holy Ghost is on the inside, you keep your fist to yourself. Because he works true heart change. You don't say anything out your mouth because he makes true heart change. Because your heart is what controls your life. Somebody say, not the blood pump, but the power of God. And what's missing in the church today, champ, is true heart change. True heart change. We got religion, Shelley. Great way is in the city. We have religion, but no true heart change. We got a lot of people trying to take notes and look deep and spiritual, with no hardship. And the symptom of that again is you run out of gas. Trying to do this in your flesh. So look at this text. Because, beloved, I want you to understand that the devil is a deceiver. And being the deceiver that he is, he wants you to think, assume, and perceive any and all things negative, please hear me, about the things of God. This takes too much. This costs too much. I gotta do this. I gotta do that. I can't do this. God is a killjoy. A wet blanket taking away my fun. The Lord wants you to see that He is not a killjoy. Not a wet blanket. Not seeking to take away your fun. But He's calling a change of focus. Because anything that the flesh enjoys leads to death. Anything, I know y'all are quiet because you're listening. But the flesh eventually leads to death. How many of you like pork barbecue? Be honest.
Amen.
Slab of ribs.
Ribs, yes.
How many of you know you eat too many ribs? What's going on? Oh, y'all saying that? Thank you. Too much salt, too many ribs will bring on high blood pressure. High blood pressure is one of the leading killers of us or anybody. But your flesh wants that. Too many cakes and pies without restraint will lead to diabetes. Y'all not talking.
That's right.
Too much couch potato and sitting watching TV will lead to weight that you don't want and you have a hard time getting rid of. You got to binge every night. Different shows, you know, every night. Man, I missed the whole season. Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, God knows. Thursday night, Friday night. I'm catching up on Game of Thrones. I'm catching up on This Is Us. I'm getting free plugs. Y'all owe me some money. I'm catching up on all these shows. And beloved, I'm going to sit there until I fall asleep. Not saying anything wrong with that. But too much of what the flesh wants eventually leads to death. And you must have the discernment and the power of God to say when is enough.
That's right.
Oh, come on now.
Come on, Bishop.
Too much football. My God won't have me growing God as much as I love it. And I know some of y'all think sport that y'all love it more than me. But beloved, nobody knows football more than me. Now, you're not going to challenge that. But it's okay. But I've grown to learn because I was at a crucial place in my life that I was about to put God on the shelf for the God of the pigskin. I was about to serve at the altar of my desire and miss God. You stand at three possible scholarships, actually four, USC, and I'm talking about University of South Carolina. I'm talking about University of Southern California. Y'all ever heard of it? The Trojans? You ever heard of Alabama? When Bad Brown was coaching? Yeah. He was looking at that boy. You ever heard of Penn State when Joe Paterno was coaching? Yeah. Had opportunity to get scholarships at all three of those major schools. And then Tuskegee at one point was good. And they were looking at a boy. I felt myself all the way to fulfill what I wanted to do. And when the Lord called me to the ministry, I dared open my mouth and tell God, in the off season, I'm going to do what I want to do. See, y'all sit in. I loved what I was doing. And I had no intention of stopping for God. I wanted God to endorse what I wanted, and I was not going to do what He wanted. And then before y'all look at the judge, brother, how many of us are in the same position? We want God to bless us and what we do, but we won't bless Him. So the devil desires to make serving God, having a relationship with him. You don't be quiet this morning. It's okay. I know you're here. I'm confident in that. Because the Holy Ghost is speaking to your heart. He makes wanting to serve God, having a relationship with him through Jesus. Hear this. Seem option. Option. Somebody say option. Even non-essential at best. And he wants to replace it with secular spirituality. When I want God, I'll turn him on. So let me ask a question as a believer. Okay, you got this Buddhist who will lick fruit or whatever they do to worship. You got this Sikh who will bow before that two-arm, six-arm of God and worship that they set up in the corner of the house. Some worship elephants and different other figures. You got them right. So when they want to worship, they set up on the table and they bow, they hum, they chant. So you want to worship God when you feel like it. What's the difference? What's the difference? Those gods are not living. They're dead. They're made by man's hands. But yet we want to relegate God to somebody crying over the loudspeaker, hello, and then we bow to the ears. I don't need anybody to cry to me to worship God. He is on the inside. I don't limit him to 5 times a day praying because that's what I do for my flesh. Suppose God wanted me to bless him, my God, at 2:15 and not at 3 o'clock. Suppose God wanted me to smile all day because that's my ministry. There's somebody outside of me for the day. Suppose God wants me to buy my heavy lunch. But because it's not in the script of my religion, I don't do it. Because to me it's optional. God, I'll serve you when I feel like it. I lift my hand. Y'all don't get mad at me. Come on. I'm really preaching to make your life better. Because the Holy Ghost is reaching out to say, I can help you with so much if you just be led and guided by me. I can bless your life so much if you just give me a chance. The Holy Ghost is outside knocking to get in because probably wants the chance to help you. Somebody wants to say, I don't want to lose control. I want to worship you, God, when I feel it. I want to be religious as long as I don't have to do this, as long as I don't have to do that. And you're putting God on the same level as those idols. So, where is all that in this text? Well, let's find out. Because if you think about it, every negative thought, every assumption or perception about having a relationship with God, about doing the will of God, about the agenda of God, every objection we have to that is all steeped in my flesh's desire. My feet hurt. Bishop got to stand before he preached. My arms hurt. I don't want to worship God. It's too hot. It's too cold in here. My husband and I are not getting along. My wife burnt my favorite macaroni and cheese. The grits were sticky this morning. The children got on my last nerves. And then we turn on the radio looking for our favorite song. I need to get my mood back. And whatever you give your devotion to becomes your God.
That's right.
The word worship means worth.
Come on.
Shit. So if I turn to the radio before I turn to worship, then worship is not going to God, it's going to the grave. He is the one that lifts my spirit. He is the one that brings me out of depression. He is the one that changes my disposition. He is the one that makes life worth living. The enemy is wanting to destroy me, but God is wanting to uphold me. So he wants me to make God option, so that there will come a day where I will no longer see him as he sent you. Tweet that. That's good. Satan wants to make God optional, so the day will come that he is no longer he sent you. So what I have to come to the knowledge of is that God, you are valid in every area of my life. And I want to see you. Come on, keep the text there. I'm coming to it. Because the Holy Spirit has come to lead and to guide us into all truth and to give us true heart change. You won't see God as vital until he changes your heart. You will see God as an option until he changes your heart. You will be in a position of treating God like you don't need him until you have a heart change. So look at this. Y'all got the text. Y'all keep it up. Zacchaeus, everybody say Zacchaeus. The Bible says he was hid. Oh, let me not insult him. Zacchaeus was short. I don't know how short he was, but homeboy was short. He was so short. How short was he?
How short was he?
Zacchaeus was so short that when Jesus was entertaining the people by way of giving them his attention, that Zacchaeus could not see him because of the crowd that was around. So homeboy really, somebody said he really wanted to see Jesus. The Bible said he ran up the path and climbed into a tree, a sycamore tree, where Jesus would come by. He had to come that way. And you know, as I think about that song, my God, I think about two characters, Zacchaeus and Bartimaeus. Oh, my God, what you say? That song, pass me now. Well, Jehovah Savior, here, my uncle cried, while on others thou art calling. Y'all don't know that song, do you? Do not pass me by. Savior, hear my uncle cry. Can you imagine? That's what blind Bartimaeus cried like he cried. And this is why, brother Zacchaeus, who was short in stature, ran ahead, climbed the tree. I don't know how old he was, but he took them bones up that tree. He had to have some age because the Bible said he was the chief of publicans. I'm going to get to this in a minute. My God, but publicans weren't liked by anybody. I'll tell you why in a few moments. But beloved, he thought enough, I really want to see Jesus. I wonder, just for a moment, how many of us are that desperate? Everybody and everything is in my way, but I really want to see Jesus. My job is in my way. My family is in my way. My financial status is in my way. I'm too short. I ran out of gas. I can't see him well enough. So if I gotta climb a tree.
Yes.
See, I don't know if we're that desperate today. I'm just satisfied hearing about him. No, I got to see him. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I just need those that understand what I'm trying to say. I got to see him. It's not enough for me to hear about him. My eyes got to see him. I got to know him for myself. For those that know what I'm talking about, touch somebody and say, hear this. I'm one that got to see him. If I got to climb a tree, I'm going to climb it. If I got to climb the church early, I'm going to come. If I got to run around until I sweat my hand, you know, I ain't leaving here until I see him. See, we've lost that kind of desperation for God, haven't we? I mean, we pray for 2 minutes, don't feel nothing. We stop praying. My God, we sing a song. song and we get tired, we stop singing. We stand in his presence and our feet hurt, we stop standing. But I was out about two people that willing to climb a tree this morning. Climb above your problem. Climb above your situation. Climb above your circumstance. Climb above, he say, she say. Climb above, they say, and say, I really want to see Jesus. I want to see him. So this publican, this outcast, he climbed the tree. See, publicans were tax collectors. They were Jewish, but they were tax collectors for the Roman government. And that made the people hate him because they were working for the enemy. But here's what really made the people hate him. Publicans didn't just collect the assessed tax. They padded the amount that was asked for and put the difference in their pocket. How many of you would like somebody like that? We got to love everybody. I love you, but I don't like you right now. Because my tax is 5 cents and your pad added to it is $500. So while I'm thinking my tax is $500.05, I come to find out that the Romans ain't demanding from me $500. You taking that difference and put it in your pocket. I would love you, but I don't like you. Amen. You steal it from me. And last time I checked, nobody likes a fee. So these publicans would pad their pockets. They will make a certain salary for being tax collectors, but they will pad it with overcharging the people. Something happened to this man. Yeah. He could have been on his tax collecting route, but he heard that Jesus was coming.
Yeah.
But then in the kicker, he was willing to climb a tree to see. Wow. Y'all, that man might bite you. But let's keep going. Keep the text. The Bible says that he couldn't see Jesus. He climbed a tree, and as Jesus was walking by, he looked up, Nori, and said, make haste. Y'all never see it in the text. Make haste. Go to verse 4. And come down. My God, hey, for today I must survive. Keep it there. You want to see me that day? I'm coming to you. How did Jesus know that? Because he's God.
That's right.
But there's something else that I want to point out to you in this text. You can tell when somebody's hungry.
Yes.
God, I'm going to say it again. You can tell when somebody's hungry. How many of y'all ever been hungry in the natural? What? Come on, talk to me. Your stomach what? Come on. Oh, some of y'all are louder than others. Your stomach growl. Some of you get headaches. Some of you get angry, not hungry. That's hungry and angry mixed together. I want to pray. I want to put some meat and potatoes on this plate. Sorry for our vegan saints. Put some lettuce scraps. Some crickets. On this plate, my stomach is saying, feed me. Anybody ever been around somebody, you thought it was your stomach, but you heard that? So, when you're hungry spiritually, you show it by what you're willing to do. Get that
satisfied.
That's good. Notice the text. I'm going to keep it up there. Jesus was passing by. There were crowds of people around. But how many people was in the tree? The presence of this one man in one tree spoke volumes to Jesus. Somebody wanted to see me that much? See, y'all thought it was some deep answer. Like there's a feeling that you get the osmosis area, works of the Holy Spirit, than any human word. The feeling of the tangible presence shooting out from our hunger attracts God. The deepness of my desire for His presence in my viscera attracts God. See, I could go through all that stuff. Let's just make sense of the text. There was one tree, one short dude, who did not like not being able to see Jesus and took matters in his hand.
Amen. Amen.
Somebody said he was willing to climb the tree. He could have stayed down there and gotten no invitation. Yeah. But somebody shouted, homeboy was hungry. Homeboy was hungry. So Jesus saw that he was hungry. And what did he do? He said to him, come down. Make haste. For today I must abide at thy house. Crowd, I'm almost done, surrounding Jesus. But he focused on one person, one short person, who was an outcast among the people. Now look at Zacchaeus' response. Let's go to the next one. Come on, let's go. The verse 6. Come on, go there for me. Zacchaeus, the Bible says, he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. Come on now. Can I preach this now? Zacchaeus did not lazily come into the presence of God. No, the Bible said he made haste. See, that's the thing that many of us have got to understand. When the Lord calls you, you don't slip around. Take your sweet time and build. You say, Lord, I'm going to hasten myself in your presence. Here's where that term attitude equals altitude comes into place. Whenever I'm invited to the presence of God, slink into it. I'm going to hasten into it. That's why the psalmist wrote, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. When it's time to worship God, ain't no other place valid. Ain't no other meeting valid. The Lord called me. I got to come. If you're not talking to me. The Lord called me. I got to come into his presence. I can't sit there and say, I got another appointment. No, when he calls you, you got to hasten. Come down. Tap it in and say, got to hasten. Come down. And receive him joyfully. That very act said to Jesus, this man wants change. Can y'all see this? He was willing to climb the tree. When he got God's attention, he responded swiftly. When God speaks to you, the longer you delay in obeying, your flesh will come up with every reason not to do what he told you. Can I get one witness? Apologize. You know this, God. I'm asleep on it. Here's a big one. Forgive. Yes. I'm going to make them sweat first. Women, y'all don't forget me. I'm not getting on you. There was a movie on I was flipping called Obsessed. Beyonce, Idris Elba, the crazy girl. Beyonce knew in her heart he didn't cheat. But she wanted to make him sweat when he asked, forgive me. That scene when he was, y'all looking at me like I'm crazy. Bitch, don't let my game out. That scene when he was out in the yard playing with the kid. She was looking at him longingly. That's my man out there. Playing with our son. But then when he tried to come in and put his foot in the door, she said, take your foot out the door. I'm going to make him suffer. I ain't getting away with that. Women I know Sometimes you want the upper hand because you are the weaker vessel according to the scripture. But that's physically weaker. Amen. But you see yourself as being intellectually strong. Amen. So when a man wrongs you, you want to pull out the card. I'm going to make you sweat. I'm going to make you work for it. Thank you for what honor this is. But if God said forgive, what women are used to doing goes out the window.
Amen.
When God says forgive, with men, we are now adopted. I'm going to make her sweat. I'm going to make her beg me. Mm. After all this, the Me Too movement, well, Me Too. See, all the fleshly games fade when the Lord gives an instruction. I'm going to have an attitude. My boss said something to me I ain't like. I'm going to purposely cause a paper jam and a copy. I'm going to do something stupid. Because Bishop preached something I ain't want to hear. I'm going to sit there in my arm full and roll my eyes the whole mess. When the Lord says something, tell your neighbor, we must respond.
Hastily
and joyfully. Look at somebody and say, attitude matters. Now here's the close. Whether Zacchaeus was caught up in the celebrity of Jesus or simply curious. Trina, I don't know. I can't read his mind. But what we see is the heart change that made its way into this man's life. How do we see it? Look at this verse now. That while Jesus was at his house, and look at verse 7, which says, they that saw it murmured and said, how did he come to this sinner's house? Come on to verse 8 and 9. My God, and Zacchaeus didn't worry about what they said because something got a hold of him. Oh God, something got a hold of his heart. Something changed him. Jesus, now in the text, pulled him up on what he did. Yeah,
that's right.
But it's something about the presence of God. Yeah. When you joyfully and hastily receive, he will turn and work on your heart. Oh, can I be more witness? He'll work on your heart. So while everybody was hating on Zacchaeus, homeboy stood up and said, what? Come on, let's read this. Let's read it. Verse 8. And Zacchaeus, come on, y'all, stood and said unto the Lord, behold, Lord, that half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him. So, Lord, if I patted myself, forgive me. Because I patted myself. Lord, if I stole from anybody, I'm going to pay it. You're not going to give him apologies if I hurt you. You know you did it. He said, Lord, if I hurt. So he went to step. Somebody say he went a step further. He said, if I did it, okay, I'm going to restore fourfold.
Yeah.
Yo, I'm giving you a chance to look at this.
Yeah.
He said, if I stole anything, I'm going to restore fourfold. While the people were hating him, his heart was being changed. There comes a time in your life when you can't let people stop you from God getting to your heart. Oh, they don't look at me right. They don't support when I do this. They don't like my children. They spoke to me harshly. Well, I'll let people do what people do. But Lord, work on my heart. Lord, you and me, we got some business to get done. I can make any excuse that I want to make. I was hurt. church. Oh, you was hurt at Walmart, but you still go. Lord, I was hurt at the job. You was hurt at the job, but you still go. You were hurt at Thanksgiving 5 years ago, but you still eating turkey. When will you say, I will not let anybody? Stop me from God's best. But here's the key. Look at what Jesus said to Zacchaeus. Come on, go to the next screen. I said, Zacchaeus, this day, salvation. That's a good place to praise right there.
Yes.
Salvation has come into this house. For as much as he is also a son of Abraham, y'all been hating your relative. For as much as he's a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man is not come to seek and save that which was lost. Is he not come to do that? He's not come to make you feel good. He's come to find you and to save you. He's come to seek you and to change your heart. Somebody praise God. Because beloved, heart is what God changed. Heart is what God is after. Many of us have been trying so long to serve God from our flesh. Let me tell you, you can't do it. That's why I can bow to the east and then rise and cuss you out. That's why, my God, I can say the Lord is my shepherd. But you take my pocket space, I can roll my eyes. My flesh can't live holy without the Holy Ghost. Heart can't be changed without the Holy Ghost. I can't without the help of God keep his word unless I from my heart give all to God and let the Holy Ghost do the work on the inside. Anybody know what I'm talking about? That's why we receive the Holy Ghost. Not to be religious, not to be spiritual, but to change. Can I throw this at you? If you were okay like you were, why did Jesus come?
Amen.
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 If I was pleasing to God.
Come on.
Now, don't mistake the love of God for pleasing God.
Amen. Right. Amen.
He loves you whether you are healthy or not. But his love will not change you unless you from your heart receive it. So you can be loved by God and at the same time not please God. I'm going to say it over here because one person got it over here. God is madly in love with you. But that don't mean you please him.
Right. Come on.
God loves you unconditionally. But if your heart isn't changed, you're not pleasing him. So isn't it enough that he loves me?
No.
No. I'm going to make a statement. Some of y'all grab your heart. God created Lucifer. Lucifer was his prized creation. But there's no scripture in the Bible that says God hates Lucifer. Chew on it. God loves everybody. He loves a homosexual.
Yes.
He loves a thief.
Yes.
He loves a murderer.
Yes.
He loves a hypocrite.
Amen.
He loves ISIS.
Amen.
He loves Al Qaeda.
Yes.
Oh, see.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
But that don't translate to me please.
That's right.
What matters is not the love of God, What matters is, do I have God in my heart? Have I submitted? But if you love me, why are you going to destroy me? No. You destroy yourself. The Bible says, God said, I've set before you this day. Come on, church. Life and death. Blessing and curse. Choose life so that you and your seed may live. Anybody intelligent in here say yeah. So that means if you don't choose life, you and your seed will. God loves you so much, he gives you choice. Based on your choice will be the benefit or the consequence. So his love is constant. But your choice determines benefit. Y'all not hearing me?
Yes.
Or consequence. Y'all getting somebody this?
Amen.
One more thing I want to show y'all. Y'all good? Okay. One more thing I want to show you. But I can't stop without pointing out the obvious. Because Zacchaeus let the Holy Ghost work on his heart. The Holy Ghost knows what area is needed most to be worked on. You might tell God, change the way I talk. But deep down inside, you're only talking once in a while. So God is not trying to deal with symptoms. He's trying to root out the cause. Y'all hear me? Some of you want me to get angry about symptoms. I'm trying to deal with the cause. I've been pastoring for years, hitting symptoms.
Yeah.
And I wonder, Lord, why don't people change? Because it hasn't gotten to the heart.
Right.
So let's look at this text and properly exegete. What was the area that Zacchaeus had the most issue with?
Greed.
Greed and money. Lock the doors, ushers. I want to see something. Y'all better hear me. When the Holy Ghost works, he goes to the area of cheese. Nowhere did Jesus say you were a thief to Zacchaeus. Look at the text. Nowhere did Jesus deal with Zacchaeus' thievery. But the Holy Ghost went to the area needing to change. How do we know that? Because what did Zacchaeus say? Go back to the other frame of the cave. Can you go back to the other frame? Go back to verse 8. My God, Zacchaeus, when Jesus was in his house, he stood and said unto the Lord, half of my goods. Y'all not talking?
Yeah.
I'll give to the poor. And if I've taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him. Did Jesus ever say, thief, get the money back?
No.
Or did the Holy Ghost work on Zacchaeus' heart?
Holy Ghost.
Are y'all with me?
Yes.
When you let the Holy Ghost do life change, he goes to the cause. So here's what I discovered. When folk don't give, it's because it ain't in their heart. When folk don't come to church and choose everything out of the church, church ain't in their heart. For years I've been fighting symptoms. Come to church, come to church, come to church. I'm wearing myself out. Give, don't you see this? Give, don't you see that? And the Lord says, son, why would you die before your time? Folk won't evangelize, folk won't go out and win the lost. Because they going to heaven, they satisfied. And here I am, fussing. Come on, pass out tracts, witness. Come on, that's a church. Witness. Y'all, come on. Don't you want to see a church grow? Don't you want to see God? And if it ain't in your heart, you ain't going to move a muscle. The strongest wind can't move the wing of a gnat if you don't want to move it. So the problem is not what you want it. The problem is, why isn't it in your heart? I got an answer. Because we have not let the Holy Ghost do heart change. I'm sorry. When I got saved, the doors of the church weren't open enough. I used to hate church. But when God saved me, when they want to worship again. Because what I hated in my flesh, when God changed my heart, he changed my flesh. And if it ain't totally changed, he's still working to change it. So I'm not saying don't give the lessons in your heart. No. Because how you going to get it in your heart? How you going to get it in your heart if you don't do it?
That's right.
But Bishop, I'm not doing it because I want to. I'm doing it because I feel guilty.
Wow.
But that ain't the work of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
The work of the Holy Spirit is to bring conviction. And when the Holy Ghost convicts you, it's saying change.
Yes. Yeah.
Change.
Yeah.
Change.
Yeah.
Your attitude ain't right about my worship. Change. Lord, I'm gonna shoot that. Your attitude not right about giving. Change. Yeah. God will keep working on the area of the cause of the issue until you submit to the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
I'm done fussing with you. You don't come to church. I'm done. Because I ain't killing myself. Unless it gets in your heart, I can talk till I'm red in the face. But I'm going to keep having church.
Amen.
I'm going to keep living in my heart.
Yeah.
I'm going to keep blessing. Yeah. Because if I stop, then you have control me, devil, and I not defeat you.
That's right. Yes, right.
But I must tell you the truth. It's got to get
in your heart.
In your heart.
Come on, Bishop.
How many of you? Somebody say a few weeks ago.
A few weeks ago.
T.I. talked about my man of God real bad. Okay? I ain't hating on T.I. because giving ain't in his heart.
Nope.
But there's a scripture that I want to point out one before he goes. Y'all okay?
Amen.
Y'all good? I'm closing.
Yes.
Luke 12:34. Says where your treasure is. There will your heart be also. T.I. admitted, champ, that he had just got home from the strip club. Before that morning, he came home, took a nap. Him and his wife went to the strip club. Still trying to figure that out. But I was told that's what they do in Atlanta. Husbands take their wives to the strip club. Any wife want to go strip up with your husband, raise your hand and I'll shoot you now. Baby, look at what she's doing. That's wrong. Oh, no. Oh, no. How about learning together? Because she might want you to get on the pole too. Say, y'all ain't saying nothing. See, I knew I did some amens on that. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. I can now understand why T.I. get mad. Because his treasure was in handing out singles at the strip club. So that's where his heart was. But let a man of God stand up and talk about ministry. You fuss. This is what I learned. It don't matter what their motive is.
Yeah. Right.
That's right.
They could be trying to ride me blind. But if my heart is in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
There will be no opportunity where I can give that I don't give.
That's right.
Because I like this scripture because it works in the reverse.
Yes.
It says where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. But it also works where your heart is. There will your treasure be also.
Amen. Amen.
If your heart's in something, you'll give to it.
Amen.
That's right.
Thank you, Robin. If you really love something, you'll support it. If you don't love something, you go check your heart. Check your heart. Because Zacchaeus showed us this is how heart change works. This is the power of heart change. I want it bad enough that I will joyfully and willingly see Jesus.
Amen.
I will climb the tree if I have to see Jesus. And there's something as a close about that willingness and that joy that will allow the Holy Ghost to get in and change what needs change. I want Jesus. So whatever I lack, search my heart. Anybody remember this old song? I know some of y'all mean that. Some of you may. Search my heart, Lord. Search my heart. If you find anything that shouldn't be, take it out. Hear me. And straighten me. Do we say this anymore? I want to be saved. I want to be right. And I want to be whole. The power of heart change. If you tell God, I give you my heart, whatever's in there that ain't right, He'll deal with it.
Amen.
I wish I had a better amen than that. Because I know God's speaking to you. That's why y'all sitting there like, you can't do anything of your flesh alone. This is a heart check message. If you pull back on your service, ask God to search your heart.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you are divided in your allegiance and your emotion to the things of God, to the work of God, ask God, change your heart. Search me. Something pulling on my spirit. It's making me climb a tree. Because I've had too much stuff in my face. I got to see you. I got to see you, Lord. Too much has been in the way. Too much craft. Too much otherwise focus. Lord, search my heart. And if you let me out, where you live, you'll go to that area that needs the attention. Without saying a word, you'll stand and respond. Lord, this is it. I surrender to you. I was a global man with a word today.
Yes.
Get courageous. No. I need you to respond. If you're angry and bitter, ask God to search your heart. Let the work of the Holy Ghost do the job He was sent to do. To lead and to guide you into all truth. Here's a quick story. It's true. It's true. Keep your eyes closed. True. Tim, I don't know if you remember. I need you. I don't know if you remember, Tim. We grew up in the church and we bought a shopping center on Dolefield and I think Bell Avenue, the old Dolefield shopping center. And we bought that as a church. Right now, we're sitting on it. It's a senior citizen's home. And there was a white brother came to the church. And we was out there having worship on the field. Tim, I don't know if you remember this. And we was worshiping on that field, drawing in the neighborhood. Bruce Trusco. And this white guy was coming to the church. And we was all worshiping. In the midst of the worship, he took out his wallet. True story. And walked up to the pastor and put the wallet in his hand, crying like a baby. Gave the man of God his wallet and said, whatever cash you see, I'm giving it to God. Here's a story. This man had cursed God and said, I will never give to another church again. Because they took my money and they used me. He backslid and walked away from God. He happened to hear the gospel and hid it in his heart. I want to say something. When you truly get saved, one of the symptoms is God will say goodbye. There will be nothing kingdom oriented that you won't give to. You won't play these games with God. Should I tie on the net? Should I tie on the rules? Should I give today or should I not? Because if God saved your heart, He'll also save your pocket. Talk to Zacchaeus about it. The reason why He hits you in that area so much is not because He wants to take from you, but because He wants to get something to you. You can't receive with a closed fist.
Amen. That's good.
You'll never have the ability to give or receive with a closed fist. Amen. Here's what we do. We don't make a lot, but all the time, the first thing that goes out is what belongs to God.
Amen.
That's why whatever we have, it's because He gave it to us. Who heard of people giving leather sofas away? $5,000 sofa. You want it? If you can pick it up, it's yours. Not a puncture, not a scratch, not a hole in it. Kitchen set, dining set, not a crack in the glass table. Leather chairs. You want it? Come get it. We just sowed a seed. Out of our devotion to God, won the lie. But because my heart, the Holy Ghost has dealt with, my hands are open, and God says, I want to get something to you.
Amen.
Here's where the miracle came. I got notice. A long-standing bill that I had, was trying to figure it out. Wasn't a big bill, just long-standing. Collection unit from a doctor. They said, we're writing it off, we're paying it off. It will no longer affect your credit no more. And I've been praying, God, get this off of me. God took it off. He touched their heart and moved it. Y'all might be sitting there and saying, that, well, okay. But I know what I've been praying for. God will not deal with your heart about an issue. Why do people fight so much about giving? Why? Because the devil has deceived you to make you think God is trying to take something from you. God is looking to get something to you. He can do anything. It may not be money, it may be your attitude, it may be your mouth, it may be your unforgiveness, whatever is your heart today. Everybody on your feet. I got to be done. I'm over time. Whatever it is, the Holy Ghost, wherever he's pointing, wherever he's working on that heart, give it to him. Come on down out the tree. I said, come on down out the tree. Salvation is coming to your house today. Come on down out the tree. Come on. Come on. Lift your hands and say, Lord, take it all. Now, don't do it if that's what I said, so do it because you need it. Lord, take it all. I mean, all my heart. But I'm not saying it for now because you don't need it. You're not saying it for me. Give it all. Give it all. Give it all. All to Jesus I surrender.